So we are the Nishyas, and we're here with Mihir Kulutunga, category head for beauty and home care.
Wonderful day to start this.
In the middle of the night.
No. In the middle of the night. I told you I'm tired, but
it's alright. It's nothing, we're not going into the theoretical stuff. I mean, we'll go into the theoretical when it's applicable, but it's not going to be a conversation based on theoretical things.
Alright.
So tell us a little bit about what you do.
Okay. So I work for Unilever. I handle fairly size portion of its business, largely in beauty, which is skincare and haircare. I have 8 brands at the present count under me. I've been in brand management for 11 years. Prior to that, I was in advertising for about 5 years at J. Walter Thompson. I was a planner and an accounts executive there. That's about my professional career.
Okay, cool. What do you do outside your professional career?
Oh, a lot of bad things.
Okay, so
a lot of horrible things. Other than that, I try to work out quite a lot, eat healthy. Depending on the situation, start or stop a spiritual journey. It happens and stops once in a way. Other than that, frolic around with my friends, drink ungodly amounts of alcohol.
That sounds very spiritual.
Very spiritual. Yeah. Do it, yeah. Very spiritual.
So, now we're both designers in some sense, and design and marketing and branding are like that, right? We're closely intertwined.
It has been something that has intertwined itself, I think, out of necessity in the last
the way it has
40,
to be, right?
50 years.
Yeah.
So it has become intertwined.
Sure. Why do you say that, though? Why the last 40 years?
So,
because advertising has been going on for a while.
Yeah, so I think the primary reason is, one element of brand management or marketing.
Mm-hmm.
And you must understand that these are two things.
Sure.
One lends itself to the other. It's not, you must separate these two things out, because
mm-hmm.
brand management is the creation and the manipulation of a person's memory.
Sure.
With regard to a brand.
Mm.
Marketing is the process in which we have codified creating brands in one dimension. On the other dimension, it is what we call a way of managing business. So there are methods of managing business without necessarily doing marketing.
Okay.
While most companies across the world have found this to be fairly efficient for very commonsensical reasons, because marketing says understand what people want and give it to them and do it at a profit.
Sure.
It's a commonsensical thought process.
Yeah.
Versus this very product-oriented world where a producer produced and a consumer had to buy.
Okay.
Irrespective of whether there was a need, the producer didn't go into the detail or the nuance of that need,
mm-hmm.
and the consumer said, "Okay, fine."
I mean,
the most hackneyed statement about is the famous Model T statement, where Ford said, "I will give it in any color you want, so long as it is black."
Right.
Leave it up to Ford.
So that's of obviously, because of proliferation of business
mm-hmm.
over the many years, the advent of competition, each player that comes into a category or tries to solve a specific need state of a consumer
mm-hmm.
Had to differentiate themselves in different ways. And what they did was they went deeper and deeper into the nuance of what the consumer wants.
Okay.
So that's why you have 50 different variations of fragrances on a bar of soap.
Sure.
And a bar of soap essentially does the same thing across the board.
It cleans your hands. Yeah.
It cleans your hands or cleans your body.
Yeah.
It performs the same task, but you see
100 different. I mean, go to a supermarket shelf.
Function is the same, but the benefit is...
No, the benefit is the same as well, but it's nuanced.
Sure, sure.
We created nuance in the requirement of the consumer.
Right.
So one consumer likes jasmine, one consumer likes lime, whatever.
Yeah.
So we've gone into nuancing the demand of the listing.
Hmm.
What it essentially does is it generates higher levels of value.
Sure.
Financial value.
Hmm.
Because if everyone sold the same thing, everyone would have to sell it at the same price.
Hmm.
And everyone would make the same amount of money.
Yeah.
The probability in that kind of scenario of that bar of soap becoming better, because remember, the bar of soap that William Lever produced 150 or so years ago and the bar of soap today are starkly different, right? Essentially, the core base is the same, but it's starkly different.
Mm.
So what would have happened is, you go ahead, what would have happened is, over time, as the nuance became greater, the detail became greater, and there was competition. And because there was competition, people were trying to make products better and more sensible towards their consumers. And that virtuous cycle kept on making more money for certain sets of people. Where there is greater competition means more investment that goes into a category. And as a result of it, your core product gradually becomes better and better and better and better. And in a way, in a big way, the consumer wins out of this.
Sure.
Yeah.
Because at the end of the day, they get better.
Yeah.
Products.
Consumer wins out of this. In a way, there is this, what do you call this? A state of too much choice that creeps into a consumer's mind.
Paralysis through
analysis. Yeah. So it's I can't remember the speaker who said this. This is a beautiful speech on a TED. This thing. He called it the official dogma of Western industrialized nations, where for every product that you have on a shelf, say a sauce, say a chili sauce, there are 200 variations of that sauce.
Sure.
Now imagine a consumer coming to a shelf and picking one of the 200 variations of the sauce.
Yeah. I just want sauce.
I just want sauce. So I mean, it has its pros and cons, but essentially how the ecosystem has now been built is
choice.
In a way, through producing choice, it has its benefits and its weaknesses. So.
Sure.
But nevertheless, it is the world that we live in. We can't help it.
So, going back to what we started off with, why has design sort of melded itself into marketing and branding?
I refer to marketing as a commercial art.
Okay.
It is a commercial art. It's not art.
Okay.
It can never be. It should. It is not.
Hmm. I would think it has a decent component of science in it as well.
No. So no, if you break down, say, so let's look at it from a perspective of brand manager's job.
Okay.
The olden method of, like, a lot of people say brand manager's job is to do communication. But like a brand manager in any company, any major company in the world, most of the time have P&L responsibilities.
Okay.
So the business sits with the ownership of the business sits with the brand manager as well.
Okay.
As a result of it, the communication component accounts for about, I would say, 30-35% of their job.
Okay.
Okay. In between, there is research, new product development, network management, financing, managing teams and people. So the job role of a brand manager, we at Unilever, we say you don't have brand managers at Unilever, you have business managers.
Right.
One discipline you work on is what's known as comms, communication.
Sure.
One part of that communication process is to create things that are interesting for people to look at.
Okay.
Your messaging has to be interesting, it has to be sensible and simple, it has to be pretty.
Sure.
In the most simplest sense of it, it has to be beautiful for somebody to look at it.
Mm.
For you to create a viable memory of it, it has to be pretty.
Mm.
As a result of it, I mean, naturally, design, it was art. See, design became a major thought design has always been there. Design, I mean, for the last, I mean, since human civilization has been there, design has been an intrinsic part of it. But design as a subject going into commercial art and all that, I think started...
Yeah, they were called commercial artists first.
So you need to have, like an average brand manager has to have an aesthetical bend.
Sure.
In that aesthetical bend, design plays a part, because design now, it has proliferated, like it has inserted itself into what we do, because most of what we do is very codified, right?
Hmm.
We don't do one piece of brilliant com or one piece of artwork, and
it's a consistent.
It's a consistent piece. So you need to codify it consistently.
Hmm.
I mean, you will never see one person doing 10 different ads. While it can be done, I mean, you rarely see a single company or single brand manager or a single brand do like 10 different variations of the same message just to impress people.
Sure.
Because fundamentally, that thought process doesn't work. We know that, scientifically know it.
Okay.
You can't.
On that point, right, one of the key strategies that you can see in digital marketing nowadays is to perform specifically that, or I don't know if I misunderstood over that, which is to create like a 100 different variations of the same key asset and then just like start putting it out there and see which demographic is actually working better with it.
Correct. So that's what I say. See, the visual can change, but the code of that piece remains as it is. Where the logo is, which colors you use, what patterns are you have, what is the typography you use, all of that is a code.
Right.
That
okay.
code is
it's
there specific.
Idea.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The messaging is consistent. Yeah. The hook for the messaging can change depending on how many people you go to, what kind of person you are talking to, especially on digital media.
Mm.
But the essential code that you embed into that piece of communication, the messaging is more or less 99.9% of the same, is exactly the same.
Mm-hmm.
The end message, the end delivery is always 99% the same. The color schemes, the color palettes are essentially almost all the time same. The typography is the same.
Mm-hmm.
Where the logo is placed is the same.
Mm-hmm.
Where the, how big the damn logo is the same.
Yeah.
So there is code in it.
Mm-hmm.
Design is a, I think that's where, I mean, there's one part of design in my view that specifically looks at coding.
Sure.
It's a format of visual code. If you're talking about not commercial design, I'm talking about like visual design, especially for advertising.
Mm-hmm.
It's, there's a huge element of which that is pure coding. And if you get that
definitely.
Coding wrong,
yeah.
Your messaging doesn't work. This
entire
thought of building a memory over periods of time, making sure that the consumer sees you multiple times and therefore builds a construct about your brand in their minds, that will fall apart.
Yeah, because if you have to constantly learn something
new
with every piece of collateral you see, then you're
correct. You are right. It's a simple thing. It's an extremely simple thing. It's recognizability.
Sure.
If you recognize something, it's familiar. It's actually, familiarity is to me a slightly further away statement.
Okay.
It's pure recognizability. It's like me seeing your face.
Okay.
I recognize your face as you
because
are.
Because my mouth is not where my forehead is.
Yeah, exactly. Now, if I get you to shave.
Sure.
By the way, Dinesh has a big beard. if I get you to shave, I will have, you will be familiar, but you will have a momentary, I will have a momentary
lapse of
recognizability.
Yeah, yeah.
And that momentary lapse, because remember, we deal in seconds.
Mm.
Market,
yeah,
commercial comms
yeah, yeah.
deal in seconds. We have only milliseconds to get into somebody's mind. Like even if you do a 30 second ad at the rate that people flip, you only get like 5 seconds of it. Like the average time frame for a Facebook ad. Now they're saying, whatever you're doing, do it in like, the standard is 6, but everyone is saying, do it in 1 or 2. Think of it like a still image that moves a little.
Right.
So,
okay.
So that's the amount of attention that somebody is willing to lend you.
Sure.
And in that point, if they have to recognize you, you are just adding one more cognitive process to the, If they have to function, if you have to pull from different places and try and recognize something, you're just adding one more layer of cognition to the entire process, and that, in my view, is inefficient.
Sure.
So that's why you need coding. Design is important. Coding is important. And I mean, I talk of design in a very narrow band when it comes to ad communication.
Sure, sure.
But design in reality is a far bigger subject. And one subject that I am not up there on. I mean, what I know about design is what little I know about advertising design and whatever else I picked up along the way. But I'm not an expert on it. But design is important because there is coding in communication.
Mm-hmm.
And that coding has to get designed.
That's where.
Right. What I would like to know is, if you are an already established brand, the probability is that you already have these codes embedded. Like you have already done the exercises that are necessary to find this, which I'm sure is a part of starting a brand in itself.
Okay.
But what if you are starting a brand from scratch? How do you move from step zero to what I would consider step two, which is what you were explaining, where you know your code, you do the slight variations to understand which one is more effective.
Anyone who's like, so the Ehrenberg Bass model of thinking about brands is, brands are memories.
Mm-hmm.
They're not single memories, they're structures.
Right.
There are multiple elements to them, right? You're right. When you say established brand, the way the logo is, the way the colors are, the way you portray your bottle or your... So there are lots of code in it.
Mm-hmm.
You need to recognize what is important about your structure and always consistent.
You
invest money in these.
Mm-hmm.
They're like building buildings. I'll give you a random this thing. If I take an average brand, say in Sri Lanka, right? If you're building across 10 years, you would put on average 3 to 4 billion rupees into across 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, 3 to 4 billion rupees.
That is a lot of money.
I can build that building
for less.
Or this building that I'm on for less.
Far, far less.
Yeah. So imagine, so that's the structure you're building. That's the code that you're building into people's minds. Saying, this is my code, I am going to continue it. I am going to keep fresh, I am going to change things about myself. But the core code, which is the core structure, I will keep as it is as long as possible.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Starting anew, empty canvas. You can choose what code to use. Of course, it's great if you're starting to sell something, if you're starting to sell a brand, it's always great to go and find out whether people want to buy the damn thing first.
Usually, step number one.
Yeah. After you come up with your brilliant idea,
yeah,
always go and meet the people that are going to. There is no better. If there's a piece of wisdom I can give to a marketer anywhere at any level, the lowest to the top, but the highest, and is. No amount of research beats going and talking to the consumer. With your material, with your ads, with your product, going and talking to them, sitting in front of them, being empathetic towards them, understanding what their lives are like, and then deciding, okay, fine, do these buggers really, really honestly want the thing that I am about to sell? Or do I have to make changes and corrections to it?
Yeah.
But that's an interesting point. Essentially, in that model, a marketer needs to have control over the product.
Yeah, marketers do have control over the product.
Not in a lot of places, though. Especially in the B2B example.
Well, software is definitely one of those places where I can guarantee that marketers have very little. I mean, definitely a lot of startups.
Software model is different. Remember, the software model is slightly more different. Don't say you don't have it. You have it. It's there, but... See, I'll tell you what will happen in software. My view is this.
Mm-hmm.
Now everyone listen. It's the Model T's problem. It's a Model T problem at a much higher level.
Yeah.
People are now saying, okay, fine, I'll take whatever the fuck you give me.
Mm-hmm.
Because they don't know what to ask for.
Yeah, right, okay.
Give it another 5 to 10 years.
Then things start to change.
I mean, like companies as established as us.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. We are still old.
Yeah.
In the grand scheme of things in the world today, we are still old.
Mm.
We are teaching our people to use tech now. I mean, we've been doing it for a long time, but we are doing it like seriously now.
Mm. Right, okay.
Still, they don't know what to ask for. I mean, we don't know what to ask for. I don't know what to ask for. Again, we are picking it up along the way. There will be a time where they will ask for what they want, and then you need to be nuanced about
mm-hmm.
it. It's the same thought I said about this piece of soap.
I see.
Right.
Yeah.
It's the same thing. It will propagate and proliferate as the demand becomes more complex.
Mm.
The demand doesn't become more complex. The requirement becomes more complex. You will have multiple competitors coming in and saying, I will give you this nuance, I'll give you this nuance, I'll give you this
it's
nuance.
It's basically the awareness of the problem that one has as a consumer. That's what is kind of lacking at the moment when it comes to the software.
Correct.
We don't know
yeah,
what
yeah.
the
so
problem is.
Those days there were no cars, so the black Model T worked perfectly
it,
fine.
Yeah, it's fantastic.
Right. Now they have cars, now they want a V8 with a fucking leather
seats
and
yeah.
muffler and all that nonsense.
Wooden dashboard
and all that shit.
So
okay.
Warning to all you software marketers, mm-hmm. your time of being in the underdogs is coming to an end very soon.
It'll happen. So that's where, so I think the software model works more or less like the advertising model.
Mm-hmm.
It's very similar to the advertising model. I should not say this, but I'll say it. At, I think, a higher intellectual standing. My advertising friends are going to rape me for that. It's at a slightly higher elevation in my view.
Oh,
but essentially, it's
right?
happening, yeah?
Yeah, yeah. Interesting. So, if you have a Venn diagram, right?
Mm-hmm.
You have everyone who uses software, and that's a really big circle.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have developers who are a tiny circle that's sort of left in a corner.
Mm-hmm.
There's a tiny overlap there.
Right, okay.
I feel like those people are probably open source developers.
People who use while also...
Yeah, and they
okay.
come up with little snippets of code and put it up on something like GitHub.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So, paying attention to those people
mm-hmm.
might actually be a really good insight for software.
I'll tell you something.
Mm.
Every school, every progressive school in Sweden, in the world is teaching coding in grade 2. Give it another exactly, I mean, it'll happen much faster, but give it another 10 to 12 years because every guy who's coming out of university is not literate in how to use Word. They know how to fucking code. They know the underlying code of
principles,
the principle.
Yeah.
Then they will start asking. Then you will have to do the, tell me what you
what
want.
What you want, finally.
But most, I don't believe what you said. Like most companies,
mm-hmm.
and I'm working with some brilliant companies right now, tech companies right now,
mm-hmm.
globally and locally. They come and ask, what do you want? I mean, that's the first thing they ask.
Yeah,
sure.
That's
a very unique. Yeah.
It's when you're doing a custom development, because that's the entire point of it, right?
Okay.
I'm talking about it from the point of
like
view of...
Microsoft has never asked you what you want in your OS.
Okay. I get it. No, so they do this. Huh? Don't think that they don't.
They
ask.
Do.
They
yeah,
do
yeah.
quite a lot of it.
Sure.
Microsoft
right,
is
that's
the best
why
example,
you have
beta, but
yeah.
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 Okay. So now, imagine I'm a Microsoft user. This is, how many times have you been pissed off at your computer?
I don't have enough fingers or there aren't enough finite numbers.
If you're using Microsoft.
Yeah.
How many times have you been pissed off at your computer? Both your hardware and your bloody software.
When it was Vista, quite often, Windows 10 onwards, not so much.
Because they are learning.
Sure.
They are doing exactly what they are coming to and say, where can I see you irritated? fine. When you try to open this, there is irritated. Okay, find a solution for that.
Sure.
That's happening.
Right, yeah.
That's reality. That's happening. I mean,
so,
they do. I don't know software companies that do mass level programming. This mass software company.
Commercially.
Because I have never worked with one and I have very little interaction with them.
Mm-hmm.
But my guess is they do bucket loads. Famous, my honest view. Famous story is that you need to give the consumer doesn't know what they want
mm-hmm.
to a very certain extent. And like, oh, don't worry, Steve Jobs never did bloody
focus groups
and consumer research. Fucking nonsense. I'll tell you this much. Steve Jobs might not have done it. All the other buggers that are investing in those buggers, they would have done it. There is no question about it. In the movie, they keep on saying, what is the numbers that come down to the first year? when say Macintosh was getting released, they come and say, you know, how many the numbers before the launch, they ask what the numbers are, because you can predict, depending on the model, you can predict how many numbers. We can do that with everything these days, right? There is research that they're trying to find out whether they, so I mean, don't ever think there is no paradigm outside, in my view, of where you can circumvent, like circumvent the consumer and say, ah, fuck, this is what I'm giving.
Oh no.
You will be able to do it for a very short period, provided you have a fantastic idea.
Mm-hmm.
But that is good. That advantage is going to disappear within like seconds. It will be gone before you
think about it.
Yeah. So being egoistic about, ah, fuck, I know what I am giving. I know it's good for them. It's not the way you should approach a problem. In any way, logically think about it. How do you approach a problem? Any problem?
You
have to understand the problem.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
And that's what you mean by talk to the consumer.
Yeah. Talk to the consumer.
Which means that it's not always about listening to the consumer. It's about understanding what the underlying problem that you're trying to solve is.
Which is loosely defined as what we call an insight, but there are many other variations.
Mm-hmm.
But essentially, that's what I'm saying.
Right.
Talk to the consumer. My experience is no amount of quantitative research is very important. This is not to say it's not. It verifies a lot of things for us, but
we can confirm if your insights are
correct or wrong, correct or incorrect. The probability that the quality of the conversation you have, in my experience, trumps it at any given time.
Sure.
Qualitative information is good to verify things, in my view.
Mm.
It's okay to look for large level opportunities, maybe, because like that's what essentially big data is doing. They're looking for large level opportunities, right?
Yeah.
But to solve the inherent consumer problem, there is no substitute to going into a house, sitting into people and asking them, what do you think about this? Or what do you want? No
alternative exists for it, because it has to come from...
Because you are trying to solve human problems. No?
It's a person buying your product at the end of the day.
Yeah.
Okay.
In a B2C setting, most definitely.
B2B is still a person buying.
Yeah, it's just not going into the house anymore.
It happens at a different way, in a different way and a different level. But it happens. No company does it without it.
Mm.
If there's a company that is doing it, it'll be out of
it
business.
It won't be doing it for long. Yeah.
Even a B2B solution, say if you're doing software, B2B software stuff, you still have to keep the person who's using the software in mind, right?
Absolutely. Like, I mean, this entire thing is called UX, right?
Yeah, it's user
Designing
experience.
Designing the user experience, where you build stories about who that person is and what they want and how you can get it to them as fast as possible.
Essentially a consistent wayfinding system, so people don't get lost.
Yeah.
Correct.
Yeah.
So the underlying principle is the same.
It's still the same.
Yeah.
Okay. So we loosely spoke about what brand was and what marketing was. But we find companies have, in general, as in at least in the B2B segment, which is what we are familiar with, there's a marketing department, but there's no one who really takes care of the brand. Or very few people, very, very, very rare cases.
That I would put to ignorance more than anything else.
Okay.
Because there's, okay, again, we have demonstrated there is value in garnering memories in people.
Mm-hmm.
That's why we spend about anywhere between 500 billion to 2-3 trillion US dollars on advertising, right?
Mm.
We have realized it. There are brands that are more valuable than the land and the machinery that it sits on.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So, and every nook and corner, I mean, there is, the entire world is evidence of it.
Right.
The entire commercial world is evidence of it.
Mm-hmm.
So if somebody's not doing it, in my view, it's just slight lack of understanding.
Mm.
And this is a very interesting and simple story to convince people. You can do it in 10 minutes. You can actually tell them why building a brand is not important, it will be value adding, it will give you money in the long run.
Mm.
So that's
the story.
What's the story?
What's the story? I have to tell the story.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, depending on who I'm talking to, by the way. But the underlying premise would be, you're spending so much money on everything around you. You build a great product, you have a great team, etc. And you are selling and you're making money. You want to make more money.
For those of you who can't see just what happened, I nearly choked to death, but yeah.
Isn't that a fucking convincing argument? You'll have to spend a little bit more, but not as much as your entire company is holding.
Sure.
A little bit more. All you need to be patient, do is be patient and a little consistent.
Okay.
And something that you don't own at all, that you have no physical capability to hold, will most likely, if you play your cards right, will be more valuable than the company that you are currently sitting on.
That's pretty convincing.
Yeah, that sounds pretty convincing to me.
If you play your cards right.
Yeah.
Coke, Apple, Samsung. The list is literally endless.
Yeah.
But as a brand grows, you also have to deal with completely other things. Like PR doesn't make sense without a brand to supplement it over there, right? I mean, but basically the bigger a brand gets, the more of a PR, more they are exposed to PR nightmares as well, right? So do the costs and benefits balance out there? If you're a company who's doing...
Okay, ask your question a little differently.
Mm-hmm.
You're asking whether there is issue with growth. You're asking whether as you grow,
mm-hmm.
will you not be met with problems?
Pretty much, yes.
Correct.
Yeah.
Fuck yeah, man. What do you think will happen? Do you think you can sneak up and become a billionaire? You can't.
I saw this one guy on Instagram, right? He swears that if I buy his classes, I will become rich. So
now he's branded as a con artist. So.
That's because you're like, it's again simple social principle.
Yeah,
no?
Right, okay.
Yeah.
The more people you come into contact with, the more propensity that there is for adversity. That's
mm-hmm.
fuck
yeah.
Yeah,
okay. Yeah,
yeah, as you get famous, there are more haters. I mean,
yeah,
it's because people don't know us.
Yeah.
There are less haters.
Yeah.
Fuck it. It happens.
That's the dark side of double jeopardy.
Yeah, I guess so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's very true. If they can remember something about somebody, they can talk shit about it.
Yeah, I mean,
that's the only way you can actually talk
yeah.
shit about someone,
yeah.
right? You need to.
You can't talk shit about someone you don't know, right?
I mean, you could. You'd just be like a baseless asshole, I mean. But fuck that guy. Who? I don't know. But fuck him.
How long have we been talking for now? Have we now? Is this experiment over?
Oh, 37 minutes.
No, we still have about 20 minutes to go.
Oh God. Dinesh, we need to train.
Yeah, let's do that. Let's do that.
Okay. Fine. Okay. Go for it.
Okay. Okay.
As time goes on, my answers will get a little incongruent again because
we are drinking.
Slightly. Yeah, I'm forgetting about the drinking. I'm slightly tired. Yeah, okay, but go for it.
Well, now it's getting to a strange position, right?
Mm.
Because we've spoken pretty deeply. Oh, so okay. No, there's something I wanted to clarify. So I sat in to one of your workshops now. When
the challenge
was going on.
Yeah, yeah.
And that was like the first time I got a proper insight into what marketing was from someone who was in the industry. Everything else I've learned by myself. So it's a self-taught puzzle, right?
Yeah.
And basically this is not what you said, but this is how I processed it.
Yeah.
If you have your 7P model, like.
Yeah. 6P. Or
6P,
7P. Yeah,
whatever. Each P is a variable in an equation that you tweak to get the outcome that you want in penetration.
Sorry, come again.
Each P in the model is a variable that you play around with the weightages.
Correct.
So that you get the
desired outcome with regard to more people seeing you and buying it.
Yeah. So brand penetration was how I labeled that. Yeah?
Correct.
Have I understood that right?
Correct.
Nice.
So how this works is, I'll give my 10 minutes spiel on. You need to create a memory.
Sure.
Yeah. That memory will be how because memories are fucking complex.
Sure. How long does it take to create a memory? If you're starting from nothing.
Depends. It depends on the quality of the experience that you're giving them.
Mm. Say it's an average experience.
Wrong question to ask.
Mm.
Ask the, again, I would, okay, I'm going to help you build that question.
Okay.
Build that question better. How long does it take is a subjective thing. Now ask that question again, knowing that it's a subjective thing.
Within 6 months, with average assets, how much of a memory can I build?
But then average becomes subjective depending on the size of the company.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
So okay, if you can put $1 million into ad spend and production,
$1 million LKR?
LKR.
LKR, okay. $10,000.
Yeah. Into ad spend and production every month. How long will it take for you to develop a memory?
Depends on the size of the memory and the benefit that it gives. There are so many variables. That's why it's not easy.
Mm.
The number of ways, see, the principle of building a memory is very, like, you can build it. I mean, we have fairly decent understanding of how memory works.
True.
Right? But what you want to deliver, the method in which you deliver it, depending on the circumstance, because how you said, you don't sell a bar of soap in the same way you sell the computer, while the underlying principle is exactly the same.
Sure.
Someone has a problem, you're solving it.
Correct. What the 6 P's or the 7, whatever, these are models, right?
Yeah.
What it essentially does is it makes it easy for us to code it.
Sure. Yeah.
Right.
Definitely.
So we are coding it.
Yeah.
It's, you're basically designing again the memory. It's like a music producer moving the knobs on his console to get the right noise,
the right sound. Yeah.
Yeah. That's essentially what we are doing, but it's not unidimensional. It's not up and down. It's not, I'm not working with
it's
three or four variables. I mean, like, say music is not working with the, music is 100,000 variables.
Yeah.
I am working with the complexity of the world in front of me. So it is design. It's essentially design again.
Mm-hmm.
Because what we want to do is we need to codify the where at which level each of the elements of the piece.
It's a huge empirical experiment.
It is a once in a way you hit upon, fuck, this works again.
Yeah.
You do it again and again. So some of them, we have been very good at codifying. So we have codified quite a lot of, a decent amount. Like all the studies that you get out of, like when you read books like How Brands Grow or all the material, that it's an attempt to codify it. Which is again, it's economics, right? It's economics is essentially, it's an attempt to codify the movement and interactions of people.
Sure.
One part of that. One sub-segment of that is you're codifying how people buy things.
Okay. Okay.
Isn't that?
Yeah.
Isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah. So you it's a derivative of, in my view, economics again.
Okay. Mm.
So that's what marketing is. It's basically you're designing something that people want to, like, you're trying to code human behavior with regard to a specific thing that they do. It's called buying. And large consuming, but like buying.
Mm-hmm.
Buying is the, in my view, again, the operative word,
mm-hmm.
not consuming. Consuming has to happen.
Yeah.
Yeah. Enough.
Okay, so Mihira's had a long day. It's tired. He's tired. It's what? 10, 11?
Late.
Okay.
It is 10, 11, exactly.
10, 11, action. There you go. On the dot.
So
that's a good time to stop things.
Yeah.
Oh no, there's one more thing.
Oof.
No, I've been asking you a lot of questions.
Yeah.
You ask us one in return. And don't ask us why we're useless.
We'd like to maintain our personas online a little bit better.
What do you guys want to do in very simple terms to the world?
To the world?
To the world. Very simple. Just don't give me 20 things.
Yeah.
One thing that pops into your mind right now.
I want to make it a prettier place.
Brilliant.
Inspire.
The world. Who?
Someone. Doesn't matter. Anyone.
On that note, I think it's a good time to...
On that bomb.
Right.
Okay.